complicated politics. And I think if you look at the situation right now, Kashmir is in a bit of an odd situation. State assembly elections are still 2 years away. And the last state assembly elections came out with a verdict which was somewhat complex, if I may put it in a mild way, in the sense that both the PDP and the BJP did very well. And so invariably, there was pressure because there has been a certain trend in Kashmiri politics where the union government has usually allied itself with the state government, or let me put it the other way around, the state government has allied itself to the union government because of the special situations of the Kashmir state. In this case, what has happened, it followed as per pattern. The union government and the state party, PDP, they formed a coalition, but that coalition hasn't worked. But the problem is there's another 2 years to go. And the kind of president's rule reminds me of the period between 1990 and 1993, where the entire task of the union government was to somehow or the other get politics going again in Kashmir. At that point in time, there was a lot of pressure, meaning if you recollect in the 96 elections, the prime minister tried to get Farooq Abdullah to contest in the Lok Sabha elections. Farooq refused. And thereafter that, when he saw the kind of enthusiasm that was there amongst the people, he subsequently, the party agreed to contest in the Vidhan Sabha elections, which took place later in that year. And of course, after that is history, because we've seen elections in 2002, we've seen elections 2008, 2014. There has been a huge amount of public interest in the elections. And why I do mention elections, because if this politics of the state has to be straightened out, it can only be done by the people of the state. And the method in a democracy is usually election. So whether you like it or not, that's going to be the way in which this is going to be resolved. But to discuss the subject now, we have with us four speakers. And as we said earlier, that they will speak for about 15 minutes each. So I'll start with Barkha. I don't think I need to introduce her. She's a well-known anchor and has we have met many times actually in Kashmir and various episodes in the history of Kashmir. So Barkha.
Thank you very much, Manoj. We were talking earlier this morning with Muzaffar Beg, and in fact, it was quite interesting to see how freely today Jammu and Kashmir's politicians, at least the valley politicians, are willing to admit that politics is actually, I won't say has failed, but is in danger of failing. Politics as we know it, or the manifestation of electoral politics, maybe that's the better way of phrasing it, as we know it, is in serious danger of failing. I'm just going to go through several varied points. Some of them have to deal with operations on the ground. Some of them have to deal with the prism through which we see Jammu and Kashmir, and some of them have to deal with the media, which is my own experience in the state. So I think the first thing we need to acknowledge is that Kashmir, I believe, has been one of the big failures of the central government in the last 4 or 5 years. And there was this massive expectation that a right-wing government would be able to deliver movement in the state in a way that a left-leaning or a centrist government would not be able to, because it would not cost them electorally. And it has been intriguing to me how little interest, apart from the sort of extraordinary adventure of the PDP-BJP alliance, apart from this one experiment, how little we've actually seen in terms of attempts made either on the back channel or the front channel in Jammu and Kashmir. There's been the sort of routine, sort of 15th August, let's have laptops instead of stones in the hands of young people. But beyond that, unless it's been kept deeply secretive and nobody knows of its existence, the interlocutor, for example, Dineshwar Sharma, has not even been allowed really to function. No one probably even remembers that he exists. And this has gone the way of previous government's attempts. Also, if you remember, during the UPA, there was an interlocutor's report. And that interlocutor's report never even got tabled in parliament. And I recently had the opportunity to ask Chidambaram what happened. And he was extremely mysterious about it. And he said, all I can say is that I deeply regret that I wasn't able to bring this interlocutor's report to Parliament. And he wouldn't share the reasons. So there was an expectation that the Modi government would be able to do much more, that the Manmohan Singh government was much more paralyzed, that it would be much more judged. And it is, I think, a matter of some disappointment to Kashmir watchers like myself that there was such little forward movement. Now, I think that the alliance has done grievous damage. The PDP-BJP alliance has done grievous damage on the ground and has been a big part of the discrediting of mainstream politics. And I want to say that I started off as a big fan of this alliance. And I remember thinking that this is what politics is capable of. This shows a certain kind of imagination. This shows the capacity of Indian democracy. And I had a long conversation with Mufti Mohammed Saeed before it was formally announced. And he told me, he said, you know, it's like the North Pole and South Pole coming together. And it sounds counterintuitive, but this is the only way to keep both Jammu and the Kashmir Valley represented in the government. And there is no other formula that is going to represent both regions. So any other formulation will actually lead to a regional and a religious division of the state de facto. So at the time, Mufti Saab believed that it was the only formula. And I was a big fan of this alliance. I actually thought that here you had a hyper-nationalism and a soft separatism. And what could that create but a new center? I really thought that these were two ideologies that would have a moderating sort of influence on the other. Instead, what we found is that the exact opposite has happened. General Huda was talking in the morning about two media narratives. You know, there is either the media narratives that Kashmiris deserve all that they get, and there's another that romanticizes everything that's happening. And you would have thought that both of these would have created by now a centrist media narrative. Now, just like we have no centrist media narrative on Jammu and Kashmir, we actually have no centrist politics on Jammu and Kashmir. And to me, the problem is that the politics of Jammu and Kashmir have lurched between a kind of liberalism that is in denial and a kind of nationalism, muscular nationalism, that is as much in denial and is counterproductive. And I find that both are out of touch with the reality on the ground. And the PDP-BJP alliance, unfortunately, has exemplified both extremes and completely failed to moderate the other. The other thing that has happened is that the elected chief minister of the state, and in large measure, I believe, to her because of her own fault, that post has been, the authority of the chief minister has stood undermined in the last few years. And it started with Mehbooba Mufti's refusal to own the Burhanwani operation. You know, I remember being there in Srinagar at the time, and one of the top police officers in the state, Shiv Sahai, was actually booted out. Because when at the press conference the next day he was asked, did the chief minister know about the Burhanwani encounter? And he said, well, the chief minister was informed. I mean, what else could he say? And then she contradicted that and she said, I didn't know and we would have handled it differently and we would have asked them to take him alive. Now, there could be a debate on whether that, killing Vani actually led to many more Vanis, and we can talk about that. But the fact is that as the head of the state, when you don't own the decisions of officers who are working under you, and you kind of disassociate yourself from the decision making, you start with the erosion of your own authority. And then she knew that this alliance, she was going to be dumped in this alliance, and she should have exited, but she didn't. She waited for the BJP to abandon her. And I think it left a lot of Kashmiris on the ground with the impression that Delhi is running Jammu and Kashmir again. And I actually think that impression had I won't say it had vanished, but I think there was a reduction. I think from 2002 to about 2010, there was some sense that politics was gaining ground. It was never seen to be representing the sentiments, but it was not seen to be remote controlled entirely. And I think we reached this sort of very unfortunate perception by the end of it that Miss Mufti was there as a kind of figurehead whom where Delhi was calling the shots. In this case, it happened to the BJP. It could have been some other government. So the alliance to me has been a failed experiment. It has been a rather disastrous experiment. And it mirrors two extreme ideologies, but it also mirrors two dangerous trends of our country, Hindutva and Islamism. I think both are feeding off each other. the fact of the matter is that when two Kashmiri truck drivers get attacked with petrol bombs when they're ferrying cattle over the same kind of sort of atrocious beef politic rumors that we see in other parts of the country, and you don't see a lot of noise about it in mainstream media, because in any case, what happens in Jammu and Kashmir tends to be ignored unless it fits into one of the two media narratives that General Hooda spoke about. There is that kind of, you know, Islamism reacts to Hindutva, Hindutva reacts to Islamism. There is that kind of awful symbiotic quality to both of these things. In some ways, the failure of the PDP and the BJP exemplifies this collision. Not to say that PDP stands for Islamism and BJP stands for Hindutva in such simple terms, but if you look at it symbolically, that's the other sort of extremity that's feeding off each other. I won't name the Hurriyat conference leader, but even among separatists, there is a genuine concern and an anxiety about how you adapt to a new expectation where the singular driver of conversation is no longer separatism, but is Islam. And since I am, you know, considered, you know, boxed in often as a left liberal, my Kashmiri friends don't like my saying this, but I have seen this firsthand, where a Hurriyat conference person told me that when he delivers sermons, he's completely changed the content of his sermons in the last 4 years. And he has to now talk about Muslim identity because there's a sense of the Muslim identity being under siege. This is a big part of what's happening among young people in Kashmir today. And if our counter-insurgency strategy, and I will use that phrase in reference to what we were saying in the morning, this is not only a proxy war, this is not only a counter-terrorism op, there is an insurgency, it has all of these dimensions. If we do not address the fact that identity has become, you see, once when earlier in the 90s when you spoke about identity, the identity was ethno-nationalism. I mean, I know there will be people who will disagree and say it was always Islamist, but my experience of reporting, I never met people who would talk about religion and Muslim identity in the way that I meet them today, in the way that you now meet people where it's at the forefront of the conversation. You know, and I remember a police officer, I was asking him, I said, how do you see the change in the last 15 years? And he said, you know, earlier, Islam was a subset of Azadi, and today Azadi has become a subset of Islam. And that is in a way how he sort of saw this change. And I thought it was quite relevant. And what's happening is that politics is getting discredited because our politicians don't know how to deal with this. So if you're sitting in Delhi and you're right of center, you want to tar the whole thing as Islamist. If you're sitting in the valley, you don't want to talk about the Islamism at all. You want to say this is only a political problem. Now, neither is true. There are no either-ors that apply to Kashmir. And, you know, there's a very famous movie by, you know, Akira Kurosawa, Rashomon, which recounts the same incident in seven different ways. And I always like to say that the thing with Jammu and Kashmir is we're always looking for singular truths. There are no singular truths. Many things are simultaneously true. It is simultaneously true that mainstream and separatist politicians alike are in danger of losing control of the street protests and have diminishing influence. It is simultaneously true that Pakistan has a big hand in what is happening. It is simultaneously true that media hyper-nationalism has done grievous danger, and has not helped. This tom-tomming of nationalism on primetime television, this vilification of ordinary Kashmiris has been disgusting. To me, it is a moment of shame for me as a journalist to see what certain channels do. It is simultaneously true that the Kashmiri right wing has begun to mirror the Hindutva right wing in terms of the sheer intolerance for another point of view. You just cannot express a point of view with either of these groups that, you know, that is at variance. You will immediately be vilified. And I personally sort of, I think, belong to that peculiar space where I'm not left enough for the left on Kashmir and I'm not right enough for the right, because I do think that there is a state that is crying out for some sort of centrist politics. Where is that centrist politics? So when we talk about this discredited, contours of a discredited polity, what I really want to ask here is it so difficult to create, both in our security prism and in our political thinking, a politics that recognizes that wrong, that certain things are wrong, that it doesn't, you know, help the optics. I mean, General Huda mentioned this example of a man tied to an army jeep. No matter, maybe the reasons were compelling at the time, as was explained, but how can that make the state look good? How can that possibly give the state any moral advantage? That's the question I would ask. This use of pellet guns, I'm not an operational expert, but I really would like to put out the question there that how do you expect politicians to have credibility when we are not able to control crowds? Stone pelting has been there now for, you know, actively there is an instrument of sort of revolt for more than a decade. I would like to know from those who know better why we are not able to work out an SOP that works better, that is less damaging to the optics, that costs less lives. Maybe there are very good reasons that this is not possible. I have been in downtown Srinagar. I have watched how the crowds come at you. It is actually a little, you know, scary even for someone like me. It has been scary to actually stand there and watch it. But is there another SOP possible? You are dealing with a situation where people are losing the fear of dying. If we do not acknowledge this, we will not acknowledge how bad things are in Kashmir. Women are breaking security cordons while operations are on. Women are going to outposts and snatching weapons from an officer who's just standing there, who's not even used that weapon against them. So what is the SOP that needs to evolve in a situation like this, right? And the other thing that really troubles me, and we are talking about the contours of a discredited polity, but I think you have to go beyond politics and look at what's happening to symbols of the state and how they're under siege. And the one that disturbs me much more than the politics is what's happening to the Jammu and Kashmir police officers, right? I find this a very disturbing story, an issue personally. I remember meeting over the years several Kashmiri police, Kashmiri policemen who travel from their village to the city in civilian clothes on the highway in times of trouble so that they're not recognized and not marked out as being policemen. And when they operate in downtown in particular, where these stone pelting crowds come, you will see them go into the crowd with their faces covered. So you have a situation where a regular Kashmiri policeman does not want to identify himself. That the army is treated differently, but certainly at the level of the police, I think the army still, you know, does retain its authority and commands respect and fear. But there is an erosion of that among the policemen who are almost being treated as marked men. And literally what happens is that, you know, there is backlash in the villages. These people are scared of the families who live in the villages. You had this unfortunate situation where a policeman's family had to go and beg Sayyid Ali Shah Gilani that, please, can you protect my family? Now, here in Delhi, I don't know, it seems to me we have blinkers on that all this is happening. That there is a complete sort of, you know, the institutes of the state, the symbols of the state are in danger of not just losing credibility, but it's worse, in danger of losing authority. And finally, I don't know how I'm doing on time, but finally I'll just say that the media has played a terrible role, really a terrible role. It almost makes every contrary or non-majoritarian point of view an act of treason. Now, it's okay to disagree with Arundhati Roy and Pankaj Mishra on Kashmir, even I disagree with them. But if you are going to call every shade of opinion, if Siddiq Wahid is going to be called on a television show and be called a traitor, he's going to stop participating in those conversations at some point, because he's going to say that these are futile conversations to point in because I've been tagged and labeled before I've even spoken, right? And that is what much of our electronic media has done. There's a complete non-complexity. It is all studio-driven. Most of these people who are commenting have never even been there. They've not spent 4 days on the ground, right? And there is something really, I'll go even further. I find this the anti-national media. I find this the anti-national media, because there is nothing more anti-national than having this conflict simmer on, having more men die, having more soldiers stand there for failed politics and failures of the state, right? That is anti-national to me. So this construct of nationalism that we have created and hyped up, this has done damage to Kashmir. It's done damage to operations. I see two fine generals sitting here, General Dua and General Huda, who have interacted with on the ground. In both men, when the army has made a mistake, have come out, held a press conference and said, this was a mistake, we're sorry. I remember after Burhan Wani, it is not Mehbooba Mufti's government or Delhi, but General Huda having a press conference saying, can we ask all stakeholders, let's calm down, let's sit at the table. Everybody can sit at the table, students, separatists. This is the Northern Army commander making this initiative. Where are our politicians? The army has actually done more to initiate peace moves than mainstream politicians. And I find this the abject failure of politics. And a last note, and I will close. There's a huge misreading that education is going to change anything. I'm really tired of politicians standing in Delhi and saying, if they had computers, they would not pick up stones. Zakir Musa was sent to Chandigarh by his father, who is an engineer in the government, was sent to Chandigarh because the father told me that I thought if I keep my child at a distance, a geographical distance from the valley, he won't get into militancy. The man comes back as the most hardened, sort of linked to Al-Qaeda face of militancy. Now, if you point this out, you're glorifying these people. It is a fact. This sentence that will attach itself to me on social media. You call Burhan Wani a headmaster's son. What can I do? Burhan Wani is a headmaster's son. You can want to deny it. That headmaster works in a government school of Jammu and Kashmir. What do you gain by denying that school toppers, that reasonably well-off socioeconomic strata, that local boys are picking up the gun again? You're wanting to be in denial. You're wanting to see this articulation as some sort of anti-national. This is not a romanticization. I am completely against the romanticization of the gun. And I have, frankly, very little in common with the, people who glorify this kind of thing and say, oh, the Indian state is so cruel. And this. I don't, which is why, as I said, I'm not left enough for the left at all on Kashmir. I'm firmly, I think, in the center. But to not recognize that education has nothing to do with it. You need a new conversation on Jammu and Kashmir. I would dare say that I'm not convinced that even jobs, I think today where we stand, even more jobs may not be there. Because all of these people, could have got PhD degrees, engineering degrees, and would have maybe got themselves decent jobs. It's not about poverty. It's not about the lack of education. So when are we going to get out of these cliches? This is very intrinsic. So I'll just conclude by saying that there must be a way to talk about Jammu and Kashmir without being Arnab Goswami or Arundhati Roy. Can we find that way? And can we find that politics? Thank you.
Thank you, Barkha. And I'm sure you'll agree that Barkha has all the passion, but beyond the passion, she also has an analytical mind and has laid out some of the issues to us with absolute directness of the TV anchor that she used to be. Okay. And so I think now we'll have our second speaker, David Devdas. He's a journalist and he's the author of a recent book called The Generation of Rage in Kashmir. So David.
Thank you, Manoj. That was very good, Barkha. So I will try and start somewhere else. Let's move to another bit of the political situation on the ground. What is the most dramatic thing that's happened in the recent past in the polity of Jammu and Kashmir? Most people would probably think of president's rule or governor's rule or the resignation or the drama around two different claims to form a government. Most of us have missed out on something that happened very recently, about a week ago. The resignation of Thupstan Chevang from the Lok Sabha and from the BJP. it's an indicator of just how disappointed and distressed people are in one part of the state. One might call it one corner of the state and very few people, but it is the largest district of the country by far. And it is a frontline district in terms of the security of the country. People are extremely disappointed right across most parts of the state. Mr. Chevang represents a very robust kind of politics. Let's remember that in 1988, 30 years ago, when he and Rigsin Jora took over the Ladakh Buddhist Association, they set an agitation into play that then led to all the politicians in Leh having to resign from their various parties and only contest on behalf of the Ladakh Union Territory Front through most of the 90s. And there was a tremendously distressing sort of social boycott in Leh Ladakh for 3 years. Now, a lot of the people in that area and politicians like Mr. Chevang had come around to believing that the BJP now represented a new hope and was going to resolve their issues. It's distressing to me that at a time when there is governor's rule and now president's rule, just about the time the president's rule was imposed, that this person has seen fit to resign both from the party and from the Lok Sabha. There is distress, no doubt about it, in the valley. There is also distress in other parts of the state. And this is, let us take on board, the most complex set of polities anywhere in the world. Sociologically, Jammu and Kashmir is more complex than the Balkans. And it has partly to do with the terrain. You may be 20 kilometers away from a point, and there may be a high mountain wall between you. And so your history, your culture, your language, your ethnicity might be very different. A BJP politician told me some years ago in Samba, and this is the least mountainous of the areas of Jammu and Kashmir, told me that yahan to saab 3 kilometer baad boli badal jati hai. So linguistic ethnic identity, according to him, would change every 3 kilometers. Of course, that was an exaggeration. But let us take on board the fact that Bhadarwa and Kishtwar have tremendous angularities with each other. We very often talk about the Chenab Basin and think we've covered the whole lot. There are tremendous angularities between these areas, within these areas. And there are different kinds of ethnic groups, different kinds of political movements, different kinds of aspirations in each of these areas. Rajouri Poonch, the major identity struggle or the political struggle over the last 30 years or so has been over scheduled tribe status and has pitted Gujars versus Pahadis to a large extent. That has been much of the politics of that belt. But that is now changing. There's a lot of flux. Somebody noted in the morning, and I think Barkha did, about the tremendous impact that the Kathua rape and murder had, the polarization that is occurring, and polarization that is changing, that is shifting the political perspectives and aspirations and attitudes to the country in communities along the line of control and the international border. This is a disturbing trend that needs to be taken seriously. Kargilis used to be considered the most patriotic Indians in the entire state compared with even Jammu population. This was the result of a survey that was conducted by Pew, I think around 2000. And it gave the result that people in Kargil were the most pro-Indian of all the people in the state. Rajouri Poonch is changing. The Gujar and Pahari peoples of those areas, people in Karna, which used to be, to my mind, one of the most pro-Indian, to use that word very loosely, that term very loosely, I find changes now. And there are, perhaps, I haven't been to Uri recently, but all those areas along the line of control, along the Kupwara district and Uri and other parts of Baramulla district, these are places where polity is changing, where people's attitudes are changing, and these need to be taken very seriously. The political parties have also evolved over the last few years. But to say that suddenly we're going to now discard two major parties because they are dynastic, and promote another party because it's apparently not dynastic. I mean, Iftikhar Ansari and Abdul Ghani Loan apparently didn't exist. The kind of idea that is reflected in that kind of attitude is that all politics or all parties of a particular area are interchangeable. It is like saying that the SP and the BSP are interchangeable because they both appeal to voters in UP, or that Shiv Sena and Nationalist Congress Party are interchangeable because they both have a base in Maharashtra. It doesn't work out that way. There are different streams of politics that have existed in the Kashmir Valley. Broadly speaking, the National Conference has occupied the middle ground. Dipankar is looking very upset and is going to come back at me, I know. And like it or not, the NC has gained ground and has things moving in its favor because of the simple fact that anti-incumbency is at work. People have forgotten, and memory is short. Public memory is short everywhere, but in Jammu and Kashmir, particularly in the Kashmir Valley, memory tends to be very short. And there's a saying in Kashmiri about how the mood changes as fast as the wind. And so, of course, people have forgotten how unpopular the previous regime was before the 2014 elections, and even up to the floods, and have now focused on how unpopular the PDP and the BJP had made themselves, willy-nilly. It was, and there's a very strong argument for what Barkha said, that it was an imaginative and tremendously, it had potential, this kind of coalition. But it didn't work from day one. Let us not forget Mufti Saab's press conference on the very day he was sworn in. From that day on, that coalition did not work. And it should have been given up a long time ago. Unfortunately, people, somehow, there was a certain kind of inertia, which was completely bizarre to my mind, given how bad the situation had become on the security front. I have been saying, I was perhaps the only one who was talking about a new militancy coming up and converging with stone pelting. I gave a lecture about it in 2011. And in 2013, I spoke about a full-fledged new militancy with new patterns having emerged in the valley. But at least by 2015, 2016 certainly, people in New Delhi, people in the think tanks, people in the various security forces, and people even in the intelligence agencies had perhaps woken up to the fact that things were going downhill. In this situation, to have continued with a non-functional government and to say unpopular is just not, doesn't cover it. It was dysfunctional.
Yeah.
And it was known more than anything else in both the Jammu division and the valley for corruption. And to have continued with it was a bad idea. But some kind of plan seems to have been in the works for a while now and was sought to be implemented last summer. It went awry about a month ago, a little more than a month ago. And now we are heading for elections. And I am very happy that the panchayat elections went off well. But we're in a situation where coercive tactics by militants could come into play at any time. And let us not forget what happened in 89 and then in 91. And it was just impossible to hold elections until 96, or at least it was felt to be impossible. In 89, there was abysmal turnout, 2% turnout perhaps. And I remember the 96 elections, when in the Eidgah constituency, there were all of 500 votes or thereabouts cast. We're in a situation that in which elections could open the door to a lot of instability from the security front, from the coercive tactics of militants. It's possible. And so it's sad that we've come to a situation where we're forced to have elections about 6 months from now, because I imagine that nobody's going to conduct assembly elections before the Lok Sabha elections. And so it will come to just before president's rule. This first period of president's rule, which began on the 19th of December, comes to an end. So perhaps in early June, around the time that the Yatra will be happening and a whole lot of other tensions comes up every year, as General Duar knows well, and when he was on the ground, and General Huda when he was in Udhampur. It's a very stressful situation for anyone handling things, whether in the army or any of the other security forces or in government, and for the governor. And the governor in normal times, when he's not also the chief minister and the entire cabinet in one. The other thing that seems to have been ignored is something that tangentially came up in the first session, that governance and administration and politics in Jammu and Kashmir has to some extent been reduced to a patronage system. I'm putting it another way from how it was put in the morning. We were talking about corruption, we were talking about other things, but the disbursement of those funds, the ways in which funds and jobs, so government jobs, we were talking about how Jammu and Kashmir is overemployed. Of course it is, by far. And Dipankar and I have had these conversations in the past, and Dipankar has argued that any mountain state does have very high employment. But in Jammu and Kashmir, jobs have become the currency of power in more than one way. One, the appointment itself is an act of patronage, and the creation of a network of support for the politician or the official involved in giving that job. And then the person who gets that job becomes part of the system of patronage, and so gets to disburse more, distribute more jobs and disburse loans and contracts and money. And how that is accounted for, particularly in a time of conflict, in a time of insurgency, is another whole story. A whole book could be written on how insurgency has become, or the conflict situation has become, a cover for lack of accountability. And nobody can ask questions. It's very, very easy to ensure that those who come for checks and for taking accounts and to come from the center, for example. And I've given examples of this book in my latest book, of how people are just not allowed to function when they come to audit. We have to take into account also the fact that on the ground, young people in particular, and in the valley in particular, are giving up on not just the political parties in the mainstream, but also have given up already to a very large extent on the so-called separatist leaders, and have given up not only on leadership, but also on the systems of democracy. In fact, democracy, the concepts of democracy and nation state in much of their discourse, or much of the discourse that is available on the internet and has been absorbed in the minds of many of the teenagers today, in particular teenagers, but not only teenagers, rejects these concepts entirely as some kind of fraud, as some kind of Western imposition in order to take control of a way of life that is far more pristine. Now, this is a situation that we seem to be completely oblivious of. And when we are playing games with politics in the so-called mainstream, we're not even taking into account the fact that the so-called separatists have become irrelevant, particularly to the young, who are the ones who matter, because there's also been a demographic bulge, so that about 70% of the population of the valley today was born in a time of conflict over the last 30 years. So 30 and below age group comprises about 70% of the population of the valley. In the rest of the country, in most of the country, it's about 60%, which is already a demographic bulge. But here it's even more startling in Kashmir. And the fact is that radicalization, of course the term is used loosely very often, and has its limitations. But to use the word to the extent that it applies, radicalization has increased, has an inverse relationship with age. I have come across 1.5-year-old and 2.5-year-old cousins chucking little pebbles at each other in a driveway, yelling at the top of their voices. And I asked one of the parents, and he said, "Kya karein? Ye chini chowk mein rehti hai." And you know, that's an area of Anantnag which is pretty much a hotbed of agitations. And that's all they see from the time they're born. But the parent wasn't correcting it. And the kinds of things I have witnessed as close as this, of 5-year-old children, a very, very strident sort of what might loosely be called a jihadi speech, the way we might have recited Jack and Jill or some such nursery rhyme when we were, I see you're partial to women, but that's very good. These are some points that need to be made and taken on board when we're trying to chart a political future and the political roadmap for how to move forward. The unfortunate fact is that not only are we not taking these things on board sufficiently, I don't see a workable roadmap that is in play. There was apparently some kind of roadmap in play, but which didn't take the most obvious possibility into account, it seems, that those three secular parties would get together. I mean, it was so obvious, it's staring you in the face that this could happen. And apparently it was not taken into account. And suddenly then the assembly had to be dissolved. So it's a bit unsettling, a bit distressing that not enough planning, not enough thinking is going into also the fact that this state is so complex. And any kind of workable political roadmap has to take into account the various kinds of aspirations and complexities of the polities in different parts of the state, which brings me back to Mr. Chevang's resignation as just an illustration. I leave you with that.
Thank you, David. Just 1.5 minutes difference between you and Barkha, so I wasn't that partial. Now we have two speakers. Both of them are professors, and they are also residents of the state of, I think, Rekha, you're also a resident of Jammu, and Siddiq, of course, from Kashmir. We'll start with Professor Siddiq Wahid, very well-known scholar. He was the vice chancellor of the Central Islamic University in Srinagar and has a very well regarded book on Tibet, I think, to his credit. So,
I, 15 minutes, boy, that clock is fast. At any rate, I just want to say that I've split mine into three sections, which is going to be 5 minutes each now, I guess. And the idea is to try and frame what we are coming against, because I have to tell you that Kashmir, A Way Forward was the first conference on Kashmir, when I was not living in Kashmir, that I came to. It was in 1994. It was in Delhi. And it is, we are continuing to find a way forward. We are also continuing to look for a roadmap. And it's very telling that we continue this for 20 years. I mean, over 20 years now. So it's a thing. And so I hope that you will bear with me. One of my mentors as a PhD student was a philologist. So, and that's probably like typing in high school, philology has stuck with me. even though I'm an historian of Central Asia, I mean, basically. So I'll take a slightly philological approach by looking at the concept note that we got and then instructions that I got this morning. First is that, you know, we want to look over the last few years and the new militancy that came up. All right. The problem is, it's not a new militancy. You know, it's been around now since 2008, which was a turning point where I think there was a concerted effort in Kashmir to look at the situation as a non-violent movement. You know, and people came out on the streets because of something called the Amarnath land row or something. And they came out onto the streets. I believe that in one phase, there was somebody with a gun in the crowd and he was beaten down or the gun was taken away from the protesters' side because they wanted to do this. And since then, these protests have been continuing. You know, and it has then, because of the events of that year, many people killed, unarmed people killed, you know, it started to grow. And that's how I remember it. I was in Kashmir then, you know, and things. So it's not really a, you know, sort of thing. And I think if you look at the figures, you'll see how this grew. Secondly, has put Kashmir back, I'm reading from The Way Forward, in the national and international headlines. You know, the headlines were not caused by the militancy, would be my argument, but the refusal to accept, talk, negotiate, and resolve, underline resolve, the dispute. And I think that this is something that's very important to bear in mind, because everything that comes in between, talking, negotiating, etc., is the key. And anything that comes in between that and resolution are all symptoms, whether you call them militancy, whether you call it terrorism, whether you call it armed, the armed action of the thing, whether you call it muscular nationalism, whether you call it patriotic fever, whatever you want to call it, you know, not to forget the demonization of Kashmiris along the line. So I think that these are all symptoms, and we have to understand why it has not happened or it has not abated. Another term that has been used and now used also here is that the rising militancy, I've already addressed that, and radicalization. What do we mean by radicalization? I have sensed already in this crowd, okay, today, that when we say radicalization, we mean religious radicalization, specific to Kashmir, all right? When in fact, radicalization can also be in cuisine and clothing. You know, it can be in perspective and opinion, you know. It can be in all these things. And my argument would be that you need to stop looking at Kashmir through the lens of religious radicalization. I'll get to that as to why now, you know, in a little bit. So I think that that's another point of view. The third is that, the fourth point that I'd like to make is that, highlighting of, quote, again from the concept note, political instability caused by the BJP and the PDP alliance. I would say that's another symptom. It's not. I think that that's a wrong statement to be making. I think it's part of the hullabaloo of all this. You know, so what do we have? Who do we blame for, let's put it very mildly, the uncertain mess that Kashmir is today? We've blamed the, quote, new militancy. We've blamed the headlines, so media. We've blamed the radicalization, meaning religious. You know, we've blamed even the BJP and the PDP alliance, even though PDP is the larger party, larger numbers party, but it's got the BJP-PDP alliance. Nobody, and is Delhi absolved from this? Is Islamabad absolved from it? And so what I'm saying is that that's what we have to get to, is that where is it, where is the responsibility that lies for this? I'm not saying that it lies only with Delhi and Islamabad. I'm one of the first to blame ourselves in Kashmir as well. But I think that we must not miss it in that. So that was the concept note. The other is a note that I got, apparently only I got it, you know, which said that could you focus on, I think there were three specific issues. One is, will the next government be a similar unlikely coalition between the BJP, that is, I mean, using the BJP and PDP alliance as the similarity. You know, my question, my answer to that is very short. Depends on Delhi. What would Delhi like to have happen there? You know, I would like to be an agent in that. But am I provided it? I think that that question, provided with the opportunity to be that agent, is something that you have to look at very carefully. And I think that needs to be elect. Because it's not just elections. That's it is. It is, and lately I've started to say that it's not free and fair elections that's going to do any good. What we need to do is have free and fair politics. And is there free and fair politics in Kashmir or not? It's a question that is moot. The other issue was, are we back to the late 80s political chaos? My answer to that is very simple. No. It's much worse. And it's much worse because we have an educated youth. We have a freedom of information like we've never had before. 80s, you couldn't even dream about it, think about it. We have social media chatter, which is, I don't think we need to argue, totally uncontrollable. We have a government in Delhi today, let's not miss that, that is bent on a Hindu nationalist definition of India. Every single one of these things is making a big difference in how Kashmir is today and how Kashmir is on the ground today. And the third thing that I've been asked to look at specifically is that, is it a new phase in J&K where politics is fragmented at every level, close quote. It's not new. This fragmentation is not new. It has been happening for the last 30 years. It has been happening for the last 70 years. It has been happening. That's why I talk about structural change within J&K. Political structural change has been affected in J&K over the last 70 years, not 30 years, 70 years. And that has brought about the mess. And I'd like to, I argue that without any hesitation at all. So, regarding the PDP and the BJP alliance, unlike Barkha, I was absolutely opposed to it from day one. I remember writing about it. I remember having a discussion prior to this with Mr. Mufti Mohammad Said Saab. I had a discussion with him before this, 1.5 months exactly before they went into the alliance. And he asked me my opinion for what it mattered. And I said, no, absolutely not. And he said, why? And I said, because A, I don't trust the BJP. B, because by the time your North and South poles sort of meet, you have to walk half the globe. That's a lot of time in politics. You know, and then he said something that was very significant, and that's why I reverted back to this. He said, I want to change the politics of the state. I said to him, Mufti Saab, you're going to change the politics of the state if, because you are 28 members, I think it was, you know, and the largest party, even if you have 98%, or let's not say 98%, say 80%, of the cabinet members as Muslims from Kashmir. You can deal with Jammu in a way that is transparent, fair, and absolutely good. That will change it. This will only confirm the divide. And I say, I've been vindicated on that. And I think that this is not the delusion of that we will, you know, sort of accommodate two strains of politics, I think is very delusional, and we had history to prove it. Ireland, look at it closely, and that's exactly what's happened in Ireland. Anyways, so my final sort of a few words is I thought what I was going to speak about. you know, before I got the note and before I looked at it very carefully. And I, let me give you a very top-of-the-head analysis of the signs for Jammu and Kashmir today. Not good. In fact, depressing. You have to be in Kashmir to know what I mean by this. Why is that? Quote, India is the most tolerant country in the world, close quote. None other than the moderate BJP member of cabinet, Rajnath Singh. Home Minister saying this. This is denial. It is delusional. And that's what worries me. Because that is what removes you from reality. You know. Secondly, lately, those of us who are in the state are aware, maybe those who are not may not be aware, but there's been vicious language out of Jammu, not from politicians, but people robed in saffron as to what should happen to Muslims in Jammu. I mean, not even in Kashmir, you know. And it is literalist, puritanical, muscular Hindu nationalism in play. And if you don't expect Kashmir to react to it, if you don't expect Jammu Muslims to react to it, then you're living in Never Never Land. And so what I'm saying is just a word of caution. I think that you should be very careful as to concentrating on what Jammu and Kashmir is going through right now. And finally, not least, is that we have a governor who has been placed there because he has been partisan, shown to be partisan in Bihar as a BJP partisan, and is in Kashmir, from my guess, again, unlike David, I would say that not for the next 6 months, but until our next elections are going to take place, which is in 2020, October, who's going to be intent on staying there because of the power grabs that he's made. I mean, there are many, and I don't need to go through them. You just need to look at it. So I'm speaking empirically, if you wish, you know, which highlights divides in the state and encourages diversion in the state. And I think that you have to be careful as to what that will mean down the line. So the situation is a lot worse. You know, I was at a meeting, not a meeting, a dinner with a former ambassador, U.S. ambassador to the States. I mean, to India. And he was in Kashmir and met him at dinner. And he opened, he was supposed to make comments. And he opened it by saying, wow, you know, so he was ambassador in the 90s. And he said, wow, things are so much better. You know, people are in business, blah, blah, blah. There's not guns anymore. So, and I was saying, what? I mean, this is, you know, he's not an ambassador anymore. He's out of it. He's a businessman, I think, and so forth. So, My thought was, and my response to him was, totally untrue. You know, that's the surface. Because we will continue to live our lives. We're not going to buckle under and lay down, you know, as just because there's uncertainty, unadulterated uncertainty before us today. You know, we're not going to lay down. But I think the atmosphere is a lot worse. I do not want to be a doomsdayer, you know, and I'm not. People who know me know that I, you know, but I think that these are issues that have to be looked at. Why? Because of something that was just said in the earlier session, and that is internationally, you know, Kashmir is not on the map anymore. You know, it's like a thing, India's on the up and rising, and all is well, you know, so therefore we just need to manage it. You know, also the fact that what I said earlier was the where the expert intervention took place, and then the previous discussion was that, you know, which is again the same thing in other words, which is to say that you know, there isn't a strategy for Kashmir. I mean, we say it so casually that there isn't a strategy for Kashmir, for a country like India. Not a strategy for Kashmir, Well, I shouldn't say that. You know, so there's not a strategy for Kashmir. I mean, are we joking here? Where are we? You know, so it's worrisome for us. It's worrisome for us because it means death and destruction for us. For in a variety of ways, some of it self-imposed. I will agree to that. You know, but we have to be careful. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Siddiq. You have taken another angle of approach here, which was extremely useful as far as I'm sure the audience is concerned. Now we'll have Professor Rekha Chaudhary, who's originally from the University of Jammu, where I met her first many, many years ago. And now I think currently you're at the Institute of Advanced Studies in Simla. A very well-known scholar of Kashmir, a political scientist, has written several books. I won't bother to name all of them, but Professor Chaudhary.
Thank you, and I must thank ORF for inviting me here and also for initiating some dialogue on Kashmir. It is very much required. I'm, since much has been talked about so many things, so I will be focusing only on the questions which had been addressed to me. So I'm addressing those questions only. Again, I was asked to talk about the discredited and destabilized political system and crisis of the mainstream political parties. So I start by asking, what is the nature of crisis in Kashmir at this point of time? Certainly, there's no government for 6 months. Now we have a president's rule. Also, we can go back and say the crisis started when the BJP withdrew from the government and the government which was running, it just fell down. Or I would say even crisis was preceding that time as well. Throughout the period of PDP, BJP government, it was a turbulent time. The two parties, they were being stretched on the opposite side with different ideological basis of their politics. And from the day one, as already has been mentioned, the government was crisis-ridden. And also what added to the crisis was the sharpening of regional identity politics. Earlier, we had only the identity politics of Kashmir, which was the problem. And to it was added the problem of the regional identities, Jammu regional identity, Kashmiri regional identity, and Ladakhi identity. And all the three were sharpened through the period of PDP-BJP government. But I want to refer to another kind of crisis also, because this crisis is in the, it has some linkage with the other crisis where the mainstream politics per se has been discredited. I think I find that crisis a much more deeper crisis because we had with lot of difficulty, it was, and we, as we know, we talk about the wounds of Kashmir, when we talk about the history of Kashmir, when we talk about the psyche of Kashmir, then we understand that there is a political psychology which is in the process of making all the time. And in this psychology, there is a 1953 as a moment, then there is 1980, four as a moment when Farooq Abdullah was removed from the power, 1987 is a moment. So there are moments and which are added, and anything which happens in the present is seen from the perspective of the past. And from that perspective, I think we had a very good period of 2002 to 2014, so far as mainstream politics was concerned. This was a period when when we couldn't say that this is a discredited mainstream politics. This was a politics which had been legitimized, which had been considered to be a credible politics, and this was despite the fact that it did not at all mean that separatist politics was no more there. It was very interesting phase in which we could see that two parallel politics. The separatist politics, which was seen as a politics of conflict resolution, and politics, the mainstream politics, which was considered as politics of governance, and how the two politics operated. And in this politics, the mainstream politics had attained its own credibility. And every election, and as rightly said just now, it's not only about the election, but politics per se. So in this politics, the the politics of the mainstream political parties, the politics was not considered to be something like which has been considered from the very beginning, that all mainstream politics has been imposed from above. And in the history of Kashmiri politics, the only good election was considered to be the 1977 and maybe followed by 1983 election. And I don't consider it, it's only because of the elections being free and fair, but also because of the reasons that the elections were competitive. 1977 as well as 1983 was very, very highly competitive elections. Then there was a participation of people over there, and the people had owned these elections and owned that politics at that point of time. And we know, as it has been referred very frequently, what happened between 1983 to 1987 and how militancy was onset. So it was, I think, with great difficulty, the 2002 period, and it was in a larger context. It was not one thing happening, but multiple things happening. This was a larger peace process which was initiated by Vajpayee. There was a promise of free and fair elections. There was a competitive regional politics of Kashmir. For the first time, it was not a politics of one party, but NCPDP competing, and the people had got for the first time a choice to have their own kind of politicians. They could reject one party and bring in another party. And that way, the politics was like owned by the people, and for the first time, there was a feeling that politics was not being imposed from above, that it was a politics, a government. When Farooq Abdullah's government was defeated in 2002, and it was considered, this is the first time that the government was ousted because of people's mandate, that it was not ousted because of New Delhi's intervention, because that is what had been happening earlier. So we find that 2002, 2008, 2014 elections are very, very highly participatory. And despite the fact that there have been separatist upsurges in between, the 2008-2010 period has been referred to a number of times, that there was 2008 upsurge. Again, there was a feeling that separatism has come back, but at the same time, soon after after the Amarnath agitation, the 2008 election took place, and after that election, even the boycott call of by the separatists, that was rejected. The same thing happened after 2010's upsurge, 6 months of separatist upsurge, and then there is panchayat election just barely 2-3 months later, and then the people participate, 80% people are participating in the panchayat election. And then 2014 was absolutely a normal election. It was a very, very highly competitive election, people participating even in the areas which were considered to be traditionally non-participant, the central Srinagar area, even there people had participated more than earlier elections. So this was a situation in which the mainstream politics was, and not only it was like considered credible by the actors on that ground, even at that point of time, even the separatists had considered that this is a this is a political sphere which exists on its own. So it is in this context that I see that what has happened after 2014 is a crisis, and that crisis that we should be concerned about, that, and our question would be that, would we be able to get that legitimacy of the electoral politics again, or legitimacy of the mainstream politics again, the way we had during all this period? Because should remember that Farooq Abdullah's election as a parliament member was considered to be a farcical election. Then there was one election, another constituency, the election could not take place at all. And then we witnessed the municipal elections. In municipal elections, it was almost a voting percent. It was a rejected election. So in that context, that then this I find is a bigger crisis that we have to be concerned about, that are we going to have that kind of legitimacy back again? I want to come back to the situation, why this happened. And what was there in PDP-BJP government? What happened after 2014? Because the alliance was considered as unholy in Kashmir. So we have to understand why unholy and was it avoidable? Why should there have been no alliance I think there was no option at that point of time. Any other kind of government means the kind of government that we were talking about right now, the NC-PDP Congress government would have created another kind of vacuum. The Jammu would not have been represented. That would have been as bad as, or maybe worse than this. So that was not an option. And we had seen that even the Congress PDP arrangement was not as smooth as we might be liking to consider it right now. There were a lot of tensions even in that kind of arrangement as well. So in fact, there was one very positive point about the PDP-BJP government alliance was the alliance agenda itself. Means if you go through that document, it's a very good document, and maybe it provides us a central political discourse as to when this, and because that reflects the reality of the state of Jammu and Kashmir, because as Sadiq and as David have also referred, there is another reality that we must keep in mind. It's not only the crisis in Kashmir. This is the crisis of Jammu and Kashmir being diverse and being politically divergent. And we do not take this reality into consideration that how do we are not even trying to deal with that political divergence. The divergence is so strong that we need to have, and I call it as a third layer of conflict. There is an external dimension of conflict between India and Pakistan. There is an internal dimension of conflict, Delhi and Kashmir. And I see this as a third layer. And in these 4 years, we have seen that how this can become actually a real basis of conflict when the internal divergence between Jammu, Kashmir and Ladakh, if it is not even addressed to, then it can become a source of conflict in itself. And this is what has actually happened. So irrespective of whether they should have gone in for the alliance or not, the PDP-BJP, once they were in power, they were stretched in two different directions because both are playing. The political parties are there in business only because they are playing with the identity politics, and the identity politics by its very logic, there is a one logic of Kashmiri identity politics and there's another logic of Jammu's identity politics, and this is in contradiction, there is another logic of Ladakh identity politics. You go to Ladakh and you find that the union territory is the demand. You come to Jammu and then you say that regional discrimination is the political narrative. What is happening in Kashmir? Nobody is bothered in Jammu, like what is happening, like there is the people are getting killed or whatever is happening over there. But what is coming from Jammu is that Jammu has its own problem. It feels that its problem have not been resolved. And so in this kind of situation, this political divergence which exists, which is real, and which has not been addressed, means it is important to ask this question, why the logic of Jammu's politics is in contradiction. Has Jammu been, Jammu as a political class ever felt party to the Kashmiri political discourse? Or vice versa, or Ladakh has been party, and it doesn't stop at that. Because we go, then we see there are fault lines within each region as well. Means the Ladakh is not homogeneous in its political responses. Jammu is not politically homogeneous. There are political divergence within. So there is another crisis that we have to deal with. And I see that from at this point of time, I see this as a very important crisis. So what I'm saying is that why was PDP-BJP alliance, why it created the kind of situation that soon after that, 2015 onwards, the situation started getting disturbed. I think I have a feeling the kind of things were not as bad as till the time the elections were taking place, but then as soon as the BJP started making a claim
to the politics of the state and making a claim in Kashmir's politics in a very, very big way. 44 plus was the slogan of BJP at that point of time. For BJP, that 2014 election in Kashmir was a very, very high-stake election. And PDP at that point of time had very clearly used BJP's entry in Kashmir's politics to create the fears, to create the apprehensions in Kashmir, and heightening and sharpening the Kashmiri identity politics. So it was like a situation which happened almost in 1986, that NC, which was responsible for sharpening the Kashmiri identity politics when it was dealing with Congress, from 1983 onwards, 1983, 1984, and it is sharpening that Kashmiri identity politics, creating a sense of apprehension among Kashmiris, and suddenly it enters into alliance with the Congress, and then there is a vacuum, and then the MUF comes. So similarly, it was a situation that PDP, which had created that kind of politics, suddenly it enters into alliance with the same party, and then the situation is it actually confused the Kashmiris. And what is happening, and that became the problematic, because again it was a feeling, because what makes the politics legitimate in Kashmir, mainstream politics legitimate in Kashmir, is the feeling that politics is internal, there is internal logic to that politics. When it is felt that the logic is external, that politics is being imposed from above, so that was seen as an intervention from above, and then it started creating the PDP's role was discredited. With the PDP's role being discredited, the mainstream politics and separatist space was certainly increasing by that time, and Burhan Wani's incident, and after that, means now we see a situation in which we have to restore the legitimacy of this politics. I'm coming to the last part of it. So about the future, when we can see the situation as at present, I don't need to go into details. This is a very, very dangerous phase of militancy, not because of the numbers, but because of the name, but of the militancy being located in very much in Kashmir, the locals joining the militancy. Also, that is what we see as the support that the militant means. You know, there was a time that militancy was celebrated and then it was delegitimized. And the peace process could be initiated only because the Kashmiris had rejected militancy. Much before 9/11, Kashmiris had rejected militancy. And that's the reason that lots of initiatives could be taken at that point of time. Now we have come back to the phase again where militancy is being glorified, where the villagers are coming to the encounter site, where funerals are becoming the spaces for the political recruitment of the young militants. And along with that, when we see that now the space for the mainstream politics has totally shrunk, so then there is a question that what can be done at this point of time? I refer to 2002 period. That was a period of hope. That was a period which was taking place in the larger context of Vajpayee taking the peace initiative. That was a time when Kashmiris thought that they could, there is a something which is moving forward, and they were ready for honorable exit. Now is a time of cynicism, total hopelessness, total disillusionment, and as it has been suggested by many, it's not only hopelessness with the mainstream politics, hopelessness totally with the separatist politics as well. And another dangerous thing is that the separatism is now led, as somebody said very rightly, by the sentiment in the streets, and this sentiment is being represented by 14-year or even lesser than that. So it's almost directionless. I think that it's not that the Kashmiris are not thinking about it. I often read through the lines, and sometimes people are able to write it even in clear words also. People do ask questions. People do ask questions, where is this movement going to? Why only Kashmiris are getting killed? At what caste we are, what is the purpose of whatever is happening? Which direction, why senselessness? So these questions are being asked by Kashmiris. Only thing is that there is a total leadership crisis. crisis, total ideological crisis, and in that space, if I refer to the period of hope, 2002, I say, means some initiatives are taken at the Government of India level. So my first question would be, is Government of India ready to take that initiative? That's the first thing which would be required. Second thing, there was a sense of imagination. At that time, the whole concept of healing touch, which was grounded in the conditions at that point of time. The militancy period was getting over and people wanted some kind of relief. And the healing touch slogan by PDP and the politics of Mufti Sayyid at that point of time, that created a lot of hope, and then that brought the turning point. So here is the question, that do we have that kind of politics and that kind of leadership available? We are we're talking about the NC and PDP being discredited, and so the third force now getting trying. But we saw Sajjad Loan here. I think he was here just now. Sajjad Loan is here, and he's thinking of the third force as well. Can he take? I have been reading through his interviews, and he's asking right questions. He talks about the practicalities of the things. He talks about governance. He talks about the things which are which need to be questioned. But then, would he have the courage to take that leadership and bring the youth along with him? And at that point, I just end. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Chaudhary. And I think we now have something like 40 minutes, 50 minutes? 10. I thought you said 4:30.
It said 4:30.
Okay, well, I think my time schedule has been thrown out of gear, because originally we thought that we'd go down to 4:30, but obviously we can't do that. So
we can give you 5 minutes more, but that's
okay, so let's start the very quickly. I don't want to waste time, but also please understand that I won't allow you to waste any time. So let's have the quick questions and get moving on that. So we'll start from here, but quick questions.
You know, this contradiction between the PDP and the BJP, much has been made about it. I don't think it fell because of contradictions. It never came to contradictions. This, I think, as Professor Wild talks about these contradictions, the fact is it was so incompetent that one partner decided to ditch the other partner to do to him before he could do unto you. So this contradictions per se, I don't think ever played a role in the toppling or the falling of the alliance.
Okay, yeah. Please identify yourself. No, just a minute, isn't there a mic somewhere?
You worked as VC, and we every time highlighted the issue of corruption and conflict. What do you feel in current situation, the governing, the recruiting bodies in Kashmir, like PSC and SSRB? Are they legitimizing the corruption? And second question, is the members who are recruiting the current generation of administrators from last 4 years, are they so much qualified? Please, sir.
Okay, what we'll do is I'll just take a lot of questions, then right at the end I'll give my speakers. Yes, Sanjeev here.
Separatists in the valley or in Kashmir, they represent both pro-Pakistan as well as pro-independence elements. These two groups have different agendas, and don't you think they need to be tackled differently? You know, they are two adversaries, and the thinking has been that if you have more than one adversary, you keep them apart from each other. Now, by coining this word separatists and making these two groups join together, has it been a wise move? My question to panelists.
Yeah, right at the back there.
Sir, I have a question.
Thank you. My name is Kamal Haq. Haq ends with K and not Q. And I think only the Kashmiris present here would understand and appreciate the difference. I have been watching and listening to distinguished speakers, and I get an impression that pre-elections in 2014, everything was rosy in Kashmir. All the problems had most probably been settled or were on the verge of being settled. And it's only because of the post-2000 unholy alliance. I think only Ms. Chaudhary got the nerve of the people why it was unholy. And unfortunately, that narrative is being missed by most of the people. Why it was narrative, you need to, why it was unholy needs to be understood. And also, there was a talk about radicalization or the high level of Islamization that happens in the society of Kashmir. You forget, in 1990, nobody, and it has been ignored and glossed over, because therein lies the genesis of the problem. Why were an entire ethnic minority pushed out of Kashmir? I don't want to listen to the normal Jagmohan conspiracy theory, but most probably you need to understand and answer. Can that be brushed aside to arrive at the real way forward? Because therein, if you ignore that, you will not arrive at a solution. Thank you.
Okay, yeah, is the young lady here?
Hi, my name is Geeta Vaishnavi, and as gentleman here was pointing out how, you know, a community was pushed away from Kashmir. I'm also a Kashmiri Pandit, and I wanted to understand what are the sentiments in the valley for the Kashmiri Pandits to come back, and what is being done to facilitate our, you know, this to happen. Because I also come from a family where there was a time where Kashmiri Pandits and Muslims, I have heard stories of how they were, my grandfather's mentor was a Kashmiri Muslim who taught him Urdu poetry and literature. So I have heard such beautiful stories, but the genocide of Kashmiri Pandits which happened was, I think, failure of the leadership. So I just want to understand what are the sentiments now, and is it being facilitated? Because I think we should also be a part of whatever will happen to Kashmir. So wanted to understand.
Last question. Okay. Yeah.
So I want to ask a simple question, that what do you do with people like Burhan Wani? You cannot shoot them, because it seems like the panel is of the opinion that if you shoot them, it creates new Burhan Wani. So what do you do with people like Burhan Wani?
Okay, thank you. Now we'll have our, I'll get the responses from our four speakers. So what we'll do is we'll reverse the order. So we'll start with Professor Chaudhary. And I think each of you can answer whatever you think is suitable out there. And we'll have the four of you speak.
I found this question interesting. Separatists and militants means how, why have we clubbed them together? Why can't we just deal with them like once? I think that's the only way. Not only that, I think we need to separate, means because I think ultimately if we are looking from Indian nationalist perspective, what is it that we want from Kashmir? We do not want to push Kashmiris to the other side. We want to bring them here so that they own India rather than India means is thrust upon them. So that's the only way. So I think the separatists are ready to negotiate, and I think one should be in a position to negotiate with the separatists to bring them back. And there was a time, I think, again, we don't have one range of separatists. We have multiple range. We have Sajjad Lone as one of the former separatists who is part of the mainstream politics today. So I think we can, that is why it's possible. That means that shows us the possibilities as well. So,
Pakistani and pro independence elements.
Yeah,
so what I am saying, while separatists pro independence elements could be engaged, pro-Pakistani elements need to be marginalized. So do we need to club them together?
I think partly pro-Pakistani marginalized. I'm not sure that they're... Wait, yeah. Now let's have Siddiq. Because I am working on a very tight deadline, so that's why...
The question I think asked to me directly was, is the state administration corrupt? And is it competent? Is that right? I mean, right phrasing? I'll be very short, on this. Although David can answer it with greater competence, the question. But yes, I mean, there is a huge sort of element of corruption in the state administration. And are they competent? I don't know. The various, bodies and so forth. I know that there are extremely competent individuals in Kashmir, but whether they're put in the positions or not, because quite frankly, I don't make it a point to follow the administration. That's another whole sort of PhD dissertation, to be done. So therefore, I really don't, follow it. But are there elements of it? And does it intellectually corrupt our state? Yes, it does. Quick answer to that. As far as the Kashmiri pundits, I want to address it. Yes, you should be part of the solution. You must participate in the part of the solution. We need to create an atmosphere where you can participate. And in that, whether it's a Kashmiri or a Ladakhi or a Jammuite, I wouldn't say Dogra because they're more than Dogra and Jammu, whether they should also participate is also very much a part of it. We need to create the atmosphere, there's no silver lining or light at the end of the tunnel on that one just as yet. Thank you.
David?
Let me just deal with some of those that haven't been dealt with. What do you do with a Burhan Wani? You catch him alive. Pro-Pakistan or pro-independence, I would... say that those are not clear-cut lines. There is a lot of ambivalence. There's a lot of gray area between the two groups. And there is a third group which is expanding and which is becoming far more important with the generation that we need to address, and that is teenagers and preteens. And that is pan-Islamism. So Pakistan has, as someone said, become more or less irrelevant. Not entirely. It plays a role. There's no doubt about that. And I quite buy into what the point that was made earlier, that the ISI plays a very distinct role. I believe that a new phase began in 2008. The ISI was clearly in touch with those who were marching towards Muzaffarabad or wherever they were. I, in fact, told people in government, why didn't you just let them go? Why did you stop them? But that kind of imagination doesn't seem to happen in government. And I was not saying just let them go. I mean, they'll want to come back within a few hours, perhaps, and certainly the next day. But why shoot them? But that kind of imagination doesn't exist in government. I keep telling people in the forces, why did you kill Burhan? I said to a very senior officer in September 2015, this boy Burhan, don't kill him. Whatever you do, do not kill this boy. There will be a new battalion from his funeral. These were my words. There's been a new army. But even today, how many years has it been? 2.5 years since? People in the forces tell me, but how can we do that? How can we not? We can't give. You are supposed to have some kind of sophistication, surely. Unfortunately, that doesn't seem to exist on the ground.
Contradictions. I said I started off as an admirer of the idea behind this alliance, and I agree with Rekha. I think the agenda of alliance document, at least academically, is an exercise in moderation, is an exercise in building, bringing two extremes together. But I think what happened on the ground because of national politics and Kashmir politics is that you had hyper-nationalism and soft separatism playing off against each other. And according to me, the radicalization, Siddiq objected to my phrase. I think I agree with Siddiq. The radicalization is not just religious, it's also political. It's also identity. But what happened is, I still maintain that I think it got sharpened, it got enhanced because these extremes were playing off against each other. There was a question at the back that said, why is everyone talking like nothing bad happened before 2014? Of course, We pointed to so many flaws in every regime. From 2008, the Amarnath agitation, 2010, more than 100 boys killed on the street after Tufail Mattu was killed in a tear gas shell. And now, but the reason we're looking at this in particular is because three things were expected differently. One, you had a central government with higher numbers than ever before. So you actually thought here was going to be a government that could deliver a difference. Two, the alliance was what distinguished this government from previous regimes. And three, you are seeing, and we can keep denying this, you are seeing a resurgence of local militancy. You are seeing it, and there's something, you know, Sadiq says it's not new militancy. We can argue about when we set the year for when it started, but there's something that has shifted generationally. And finally, I think the biggest crisis, the elephant in the room, tomorrow you get a government in Delhi that's ready to talk. Who is this government going to talk to? Because the Hurriyat has only, according to me, symbolic value. If you actually put it down to the ground, neither are they going to come to the table, nor do they represent anyone but their pocket constituencies. It's a symbol. They stand for that symbol of separatism. There is the biggest crisis today, and what every interlocutor is facing is there is no one to talk to.
About the Kashmiri Pandits only, because I just wanted to add this point about Kashmiri Pandits in the sense it's important for the Kashmiri Pandits to come back to Kashmir, not only for the Kashmiri Pandits. It's important for Kashmiri society. Yes. If it wants to justify its Kashmiriyat, its secularism, its political ethos, it has to bring back the Kashmiri Pandit. Otherwise, it's the major crisis for Kashmir. It has become one religion society and it will remain one religion society. It has lost its mixed culture.
Because we've been using the word Islamization and Islamic radicalism, etc., on the thing, is that, you know, this is, again, not a homogeneous thing. Just like Hindu radicalization or Hindu whatever is a homogeneous sort of entity. I remember as a child in the late 60s, you know, talking, and I remember my grandfather complaining, because he had come from Lhasa in central Tibet, and he was complaining that Kashmiris never pray. You know, what is wrong with them? They go on Fridays and they don't, you know, and stuff. So that, I mean, I'm not using that as an example of not being Muslim, but just the fact that there was a relaxed attitude, you know, as such, and it has changed. That will change if you have 30 years of mayhem, because the farmer, the person on the street, the person who's been jobless all his life, is going to say, turn to somebody. You know, and they are turning to that. That's why the mosques are filled. Not everybody you see wearing a white cap and raising their trousers is a militant. One thing to bear in mind, and I'm willing to wager, maybe ORF can sponsor this study, but I'm willing to wager that 80% of what you see display of overt Islam is piety. Just looking for somewhere to go so that maybe out of the rest, maybe we're talking about 15%, maybe 18% of the people are people who understand something of political Islam. And political Islam is not violent necessarily. It is conflating politics and Islam. And then, do we have a literalist, sort of dangerous, criminal form of Islam there? I don't know. Maybe it has taken root. I still don't know. I don't know enough about the ground. I don't know enough. I don't have access to the intelligence sources and so forth. Nor do I want access, because that. Yeah. But I think that is the question we have to ask. And that's a very small minority. You know, and when somebody asked me once, you know, has it taken root? And I said, yes, maybe it has. This was very recently. And the question that she asked me was, how deep is it? And I said, well, that's the quality of roots, is that you don't see it until it flowers, then it's too late. You know, so I think that stratifying is very important, and not be looking at Islamicization in a sort of homogeneous manner, particularly in Kashmir. You know, and that is not denial so much as recognizing, I think, certain facts.
Thank you, Siddiq. I think you'll agree with me that we've had an incredibly rich discussion here. The title of the panel was Contours of Discredited Politics. And what I took away was what Professor Chaudhary said about the worry about the legitimacy of the political process itself. In the sense, we have, Kashmir has a history. We know the 87 election, we know the 83 election, we know the 90s, the two elections in 96. And so when we have reached this pass, the worry is that if the electoral process itself loses legitimacy, then you lose much more than simply, counting, ministers or numbers or governance or things like that, because this legitimacy has been constructed with a great amount of effort, huge amount of sacrifice. This didn't come easily, this legitimacy in Kashmir, because there was a huge history behind that whole process. Finally, what I'd like to point out also is, there is a problem for the union government. And the problem for the union government when it comes to Jammu is that the union government's political predecessor, the Bharatiya Jan Sangh, has its roots in Jammu. And one of the parts, the key part of its roots is that is the Praja Shakti, the Praja Parishad movement, which basically denied the idea that Kashmir should have autonomy of any kind. And so, there is a kind of a structural problem there, in the sense, how do you unfreeze the politics? Because you have a party, two parties in partnership. One party actually believes there should be less autonomy, and the other party believes that there should be more autonomy. And yet they were together in this coalition. But in any case, these are things which you can be a takeaway for you. All I'd request you here is to give a hand to our panel here. Thank you. And I think now there'll be a quick interchange for the next speaker. Yeah, Khalid.